Welcome to this week's episode on the DevOps Lab. With us this week, we have Kendra Havens, and we're going to talk about testing in Visual Studio. So tune in because you don't want to miss out on this awesome episode. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. With us this week, we have a very special guest, Kendra Havens. Welcome, Kendra.
Hi, April. Thanks for having me.
Really excited to have you on the show here because you're covering off a very important topic today, testing in Visual Studio.
Yeah. So, hi, I'm all about testing in Visual Studio. I actually get to work on this every day. I'm a program manager on the Visual Studio team and the .NET team, but I cover just the testing experience across both of those. So all of our test tools and our test platforms and the underlying runners and frameworks and libraries and everything that helps us test.
That's awesome. And I think testing is kind of one of these dark horse arts that as a developer, even in ops, like we don't talk about testing enough because we don't have enough experience with it and maybe how to get started. So can you take it away and tell us how to get started with testing in Visual Studio?
Absolutely. And I totally agree. A lot of this episode and this module is just for students who maybe missed that day in CS or their labs didn't cover it or something. And they kind of got into their professional jobs and were like, okay, I was told to write tests. I hear that this is like sort of a cultural thing that people do now, which wasn't the case in college or whatever, or their coding camps or wherever they were. They were just trying to kind of churn out gaps. Yep. So I have some MSLearn testing modules that I'd like to share. And I guess we can hop over to my screen if people are already interested in starting out. So we do have Using Visual Studio for Modern Development is a learning path on MSLearn, and all of these links will be in the description below. And there's two modules that are part of this that are related to testing right now. It's Introduction to Software Testing Concepts and C# Testing in Visual Studio, which digs a lot more into the actual tools and writing the test. So the first one is sort of software concepts, like why we test, what are the different types of testing and different testing schools of thought. And then the second one is more about, okay, you can view, run, debug, write a whole test suite, and then sharpen your test schools with learning more about fluent assertions and mocking it, and you know, just stuff that's a bit later down the road.
Cool.
So one of the things that I really, really dig into in this first one, into Introduction to Software Testing Concepts, is why we test, honestly. So chances are a lot of the students out there today, you create an app and you use it over and over and over again to make sure the functionality is right. That's actually a type of testing. That's what we call manual testing, is actually stepping through, pressing F5, entering whatever data you need to enter, and making sure your app behaves the same way. And I know as a student, I did this a bajillion times. I did it so many times in various situations because I wanted to make sure my app performed. I didn't know that testing could save me all that work.
Yeah.
So a lot of times I wanted to step through my app, especially to get to a specific function that I just added, but it was like five steps in. I needed to create a user account or enter data or whatever. And then I would be able to test, you know, and use what I actually wanted. Tests can kind of skip all of these manual steps and dig right in and call your code and enter in whatever parameters or data that you wanted to sort of enter and do it in an automated way. So that also, if I add new functionality on top of that, I can still rerun all of those tests that I did in the past. So it kind of helps me not need to repeat a ton of behavior, a ton of manual testing, and it automates it. So I can run all of those different scenarios with the click of a button. And it actually kind of documents what scenarios I already have covered. So it's kind of a point in time reference where I can say, this is all the things that I expect this code to be able to do. Tell me if it passes or fails.
Yeah, and it's something we talk a lot about in DevOps principles, and without even calling it DevOps, just in development principles, et cetera. Like, we want to test things early and often because we just don't want to deploy something and say it worked on my machine, or it went to production, or we went to deploy something, we know why it didn't work. And having that traceability of going, right, I ran this test, this is how it worked, and maybe it didn't work, and here's why. That traceability piece is also really important to testing things early and often, and addressing these issues earlier on the process. And we talk about shifting left in DevOps, right? So when we do things early and often, it's because we introduce most of the bugs in development. So if we can address that in development, it saves us a lot down the road and saves our bacon over and over again.
Absolutely saves the bacon. Love this term. So I think, so just after you kind of understand why you test, I think one of the main things is, but how do we test is the next step. What are sort of the industry standards of what people do? And we actually have this thing called a testing pyramid that I think we could talk a little bit about. And you can kind of read more in depth of what each type of test is. But I mentioned that manual tests are very kind of expensive, and it's expensive to run. They're expensive to kind of create. You're spending all of this time running your app, entering everything in manually yourself. I would actually categorize that as an acceptance test. So it's kind of at the top of the pyramid. This represents, you shouldn't have many of them because they're difficult to run, difficult to create. And then at the bottom of the pyramid, you have things like unit tests, which are really, really easy to run. They're, you know, automated. They might test sort of the smallest component of your code. So maybe one method or the smallest kind of possible logic unit. So it might even test like within a method, a specific logic branch or something like that. And then you can kind of step up. Integration would test, you know, more than one thing across your code. So we kind of have this organization to what types of tests that you're writing. As a beginner, I think a lot of people accidentally fall into this thing where they write these huge, huge integration tests because they're kind of trying to recreate what they would do as a user. And that's good. It's good to have those, but you don't want all of your tests to be doing that. The more you kind of componentize and create these unit tests, the more likely they will be able to kind of keep up to date, and the easier they are to debug too. When it's just, oh, this one test is failing, I know exactly what it tests and exactly what is wrong in that case.
Absolutely. Unit tests are king, and we run lots of them within Microsoft amongst all our software as well when we're deploying it. So unit tests are absolutely king in software development.
Absolutely. That's why they're my foundation, the base of the pyramid.
Love it. Love it. Unit tests is the base.
And I think the last unit I'll just talk about really briefly in this MSLearn module is our testing schools of thought. So when you're a beginner, you'll also have a lot of people throwing these acronyms at you, TDD, BDD, DRY, whatever. This module goes into those a little bit. I think the most popular one is TDD or test-driven development. This is sort of a, not sure if I should say it's an extreme form of testing, but it's a a preventive form of testing. It's all about writing your tests before you actually write your product code. So you write a test that fails, and then you write the product code to get it passing. And a lot of people actually really love this sort of pattern when they're doing any kind of development, because it gets them very, very focused on exactly what they're trying to do in sort of a very ordered way. So they write out sort of what the test is. And I have a little screenshot here of what this might look like in .NET. So I have a calculator class. My add method on the right side is throwing a not implemented exception. And they'll create a test for it that says like, okay, I expect putting one and one into my add calculator to return two. Yep. And right now the test is failing. So now I know what I'm going to do is make that add, implement that add function. So it kind of gives order to people's days and what tasks they're trying to complete.
And it gives you something to aim for, especially when you're writing your code.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. So there's a few more, you know, red, green, refactor, BDD for behavior-driven development, don't repeat yourself, and just kind of more details on what each of those are. Yeah. But you think we should dive into some code?
Let's do it. I love code. Let's get started.
Awesome. I also want to talk about how Visual Studio can kind of help you get started testing as well. So the second module on here is actually going to be a lot more hands-on. So it is the C# testing in Visual Studio, and it'll actually take you through all the steps of creating a unit test. So I actually used a calculator example before. It takes you through kind of creating a calculator app and all the different ways you can test it and kind of work different parts of the testing framework just to get sort of a basic, you know, get familiar with how your project calls your product code, how your test methods can kind of map to all of your product code methods when you are doing that unit testing. I'll go ahead and create a project in Visual Studio, and I'll just call this Learn Calculator. And I'm just creating a class library that's targeting .NET 6.0. So we're going to be doing a little bit of C# today.
Awesome.
I'll go ahead and use these helpful buttons to copy out what I need here. And I'll go ahead and start with a calculator test. And I'll actually scroll a little bit further. Here we go. So now I'll just create that add method in the calculator. Mm-hmm. So for this example, I'm not going to be doing, test-driven development. I'm copying in the actual product code first. So this is a little calculator app that I have. It's just a class library. I'll actually go ahead and use some helpful Visual Studio tooling. So since I changed the name of my class, it can actually prompt me in this little screwdriver that I can rename my file as well. So now it's calculator.cs. Ooh, sorry.
Very fancy.
Oh, I love keeping things consistent.
It is.
And when it's just in this little, screwdriver, it's a nice little feature. Okay, so the thing that this tutorial will show is there's some really, really easy ways to create unit tests right from Visual Studio. So all I did was right-click inside of a method in product code. That's it, right? And there's this option where I can create a unit test. It'll actually generate the test project for me and add references and all this good stuff. So I'll go ahead and just click OK, because I accepted the defaults. I didn't change anything. So this is just what you get. So it went ahead and created this project for me. And you can check all of your test projects need to reference the product code that they are testing. So it automatically added this Learn Calculator 02 reference for me, and it added this add test. So it knew that it needed to take my method that I wanted to generate a test off of. All it did was append the word test, and it copied it into my test method and kind of set it up for me.
That's awesome.
So right now it is failing, which I like. So if I right-click, run this in Visual Studio, it will not pass, which we like, because we actually always want to see a test fail at least once when we're writing it. Otherwise, how do we know if it ever, you know, actually tested anything meaningful, if we messed up an assert or somewhere or something? So I like that it's failing right now. So let's go ahead and make this a more meaningful test, and I'll go back over to this guy, and maybe we have enough room to actually put these side by side. I'll go ahead and do that. I think that looks okay. So we kind of have the calculator here, and I'll go ahead and copy in this add test. So we have a little bit more of a test method here.
Cool.
So just to break this down really quick, testing can have three different parts in general. Here I'm introducing the concepts of arrange, act, and assert. So arrange is just organizing what we need to call the data that we need to have available in order to execute the test. The act is when you actually call something, you actually are calling the product code. So I'm going to try to add one with 1 + 1 with my calculator. And the assert thing is the most important part of the test. So asserts decide if a test passes or fails. So here I'm asserting it equals to, and then this actual is what the result actually returns and when in the act step. So there's a bunch of different asserts that you can use to kind of explore your code a little bit more. And I go into them a little bit here. So we can kind of copy in a little bit more of these assert statements and take a look at them. So I don't have subtract implemented yet, but that's okay. So here I have like assert is null. We can have r equal. We can have r the same. We used fail before when it was not implemented or inconclusive. So asserts are all the different ways that you need to kind of verify that these conditions are what the test needs to be passing. So you can do string asserts for contains or is true and all kinds of conditions, all kind of object comparisons.
You can add as many conditions as you need to for the code you're writing.
Absolutely. And so if any one of them fail, if only one out of your whole list fails, then the test fails.
Yep.
And so you kind of know what to dig into based on your assert methods, because it's really clear what needs to be true here. So that was just a little bit of introduction. There's a bunch of cool features in the Visual Studio in general. One of the new ones that I really like is right-click Show in Test Explorer.
Yes.
If we hop over to my screen really quickly, I can kind of introduce the Test Explorer. So when anytime your cursor is inside of a test method, you can right-click Show in Test Explorer, and it'll actually open this Test Explorer pane that always shows you all the tests that are currently discovered, so you can manage them, which gets more and more important when you're dealing with like larger test suites and that kind of thing. You can also filter to what tests are failing right now and kind of take a look at that as well. So that's kind of one thing to be aware of. So really love the kind of extra Visual Studio features, little things that help you navigate your test suite, and check out those learn modules that help you kind of get introduced to testing, get more comfortable with it, make sure you're kind of doing the right thing. You can branch out and learn more advanced testing concepts, but it's really, really good to start out with unit tests and kind of get a little bit familiar with, what they look like.
Absolutely. Kendra, awesome. That is great. I didn't know you could right click and create a unit test that gave you some defaults, because the last time I wrote a unit test in C#, it did not go that smoothly. and to be fair, it's, it was a few months ago, but it's great seeing these little things that make it easier for engineers and developers to write tests, because tests are so, so crucial to what we do in all the code we write. So thank you so much. And for everyone watching, again, we're going to put links to all these assets for Microsoft Learn, some great, knowledge reviews, how to get started. And everyone, thank you for joining. And maybe you'll join us next time. Kendra and I might take this a little bit further and talk about more testing in Visual Studio. So thank you, everyone, and see you again next time.